Step.
All we're going for is like, a good game of football, a good time chat and a good piss up.
Standing by. And we saw clearly the thuggery of a group of hooligans who could never have claimed to have come along simply to enjoy the football.
If some dirty northern punt spits over me, I'll put a fucking pint glass in his head.
Football, the preserve of fathers and sons for generations, was in crisis. Many young fans were carried away by a culture of casual violence.
And then they stood in the street exposing themselves. And when I say exposing themselves, I mean exposing themselves.
And they've got to put him in jail. They've got to. Either that or they've got to publicly birch.
Railway stations, high streets, motorway services. Come Saturday afternoons, these were the realms of football's boot boys.
Every football club had its gangs. And at 3 o'clock on a Saturday, cities across the land braced themselves for the inevitable.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Police arrangements for the match today.
Football violence had become a brutal nationwide epidemic.
This is a photograph showing some of the horrific weapons the police confiscated from suspected hooligans. There's an axe, a meat cleaver, knives, scissors, daggers, darts. It's a truly extraordinary assortment of hardware. Some of the weapons, though, were a little bit more imaginative. The police even confiscated a hairbrush.
Many older fans were horrified. And nobody captured their disgust better than the Manchester United legend, Sir Matt Busby.
We don't want them. I wish we could find them and throw them in the river or something.
What made football hooliganism so deeply disturbing was that it was such a public and unashamed exhibition of raw tribal aggression. Britain was supposed to be the country of the stiff upper lip, a land where youngsters obeyed the law, the streets were safe, and a spirit of quiet moderation ruled our daily lives. But now a new generation, apparently steeped in bloodshed, appeared to be defying everything that Britain stood for. For decades, generations of men, young and old, had watched their local teams side by side. But in the mid-70s, as men developed new interests and wider responsibilities, that tradition broke down. This wasn't just a story about football. This seemed to capture so much of what was wrong with Britain. The scenes of appalling violence suggested that the nation was tearing itself apart and that traditional moral values respected for generations had simply collapsed.
The Lions of Millwall have earned their reputation the hard way. At the bottom of the hierarchy are the youngsters. They call themselves the halfway line, and when it comes to aggro, they imitate their elders. Some of them graduated treatment. They're the ones in the surgical masks. Although one of Millwall's heavy mobs, treatment don't pick fights, but they're always there when they happen. In the trench warfare of the terraces, it's F Troop who go over the top. F Troop are the real nutters, self-confessed loonies like Harry the dog, who go looking for fights and are seldom disappointed.
Every face, even the one you saw.
today, 'cause everything's changed since yesterday, in every possible way. Things seem different today, not like yesterday. Is days never change and it's 3 years later. It's like your life hasn't changed and it's 3 years late. How does it feel to be 3 years late and watching your youth drift away? What seems different seems different today. What seems different today.
There's quite a crush behind that goal, and I think we're going to have some trouble there unless the police can act very quickly. That's been a tight little spot there way before the start of the game when the crowd came rushing in there. They've had their spots of bother there, and if we go a little to the left you can see that there's a whole cordon of policemen up in that top corner, and because they've made a gap there in order to keep the peace, it means that people have been pushed forward. And I think the game will have to be held up for a few minutes here until that frightening congestion down there can be relieved. I think they're going to have to allow a lot of those people who are in that very congested area to come across the barrier onto the field and maybe go round to the other end where it's less congested. There were numerous loudspeaker appeals before the start to ask 2,000 or 3,000 who were in that corner to move to areas in the field or to shift along a little bit where it was less congested immediately behind the goal. That advice wasn't heeded. And there's confusion and total confusion there at the moment. The pitch, and I'm bound to say if I were on that side of the field I would also want to get onto the pitch away from it as well. And Peter Reeves, the referee, is calling the players off the field, and that is the only sensible thing that he can do. It's absolutely pointless for the players to be standing there, and Peter Reeves has made exactly the right decision. I notice that Tommy Kavanagh's coming onto the field as well, getting Manchester United players away from that scene. And the players are being called off the field. The delay has already been some 5 minutes. And I would think it'll be a good few minutes yet before we can start again. Tommy Kavanagh calling one player away, Sammy McElroy. And now it'll be down to the police and the first aid men and the West Ham club officials to try and sort out the disorder that we see in that corner of the ground. I'm sure the only answer is to allow people to come across that barrier and onto the field for their own safety. The police really have a thankless job there. And they've got to have a fair bit of courage, I think, and some fairly strong wills to go in there and deal with that situation. And even the West Ham manager, Ron Greenwood, now down on the field, he's been talking to police officials. But slowly but surely, it seems that the police forces are there, are getting to grips with this situation. And slowly but surely, the congestion is easing behind that goal. Well, Peter Reeves and one of his linesmen coming back onto the field. The applause coming to them from the crowd. I think they appreciate what a difficult time it's been for the referee. Made.
I'm on top, but you're trying to stop me now. television, scenes of apparent total mayhem or something like that. If you look very closely, there is still something happening, usually to prevent people getting killed and so on. When you see somebody lying on the ground with about 10 people around kicking him, there is still something there which is preventing those boots going in very hard. Otherwise, he'll be lying there dead afterwards. It'd be very easy to kill him. People don't get killed in those situations, or at least very, very rarely. So there is still something left of the rule framework, even though all the ceremonial aspects, the ritual chanting, the capitalism, even
just before the Chelsea kickoff, there were clashes involving Millwall fans who moved into an area usually occupied by Chelsea supporters. They tried to make their way upfield. Police moved in, including a dozen on horseback. At the other end, more Millwall supporters surged forward and a barrier gave way. Tonight, police say there were at least 50 arrests at the match.
At Stamford Bridge, there was no score between Chelsea and Millwall at half-time. And Chelsea, in the old blue strip, began the second half with an all-out attack on the Millwall goal. But it was Millwall who took the lead from a corner. Grizzly scored the goal in the 62nd minute.
Just about ready for the start. And there are going to be injuries and problems there, and a holding up of the game without any doubt at all by Derek Niffard. I would have thought there's no way that goal can continue. And there are going to be a wall collapse there. The play going on at the other end as the ball goes back to Peter Bonetti. And there's no way the game can continue. And in fact, there's trouble all around this ground. There are going to be some bad injuries there. It was a surging crowd that came down within the first seconds of the game when John Jackson took that shot from Tommy Langley. A wall was collapsed within seconds. And now I think the delay is going to be a long one. That's the problem. There are people on the pitch. I've seen girls out there crying with the shock of it all. And in fact, down on two sides of the ground, not only behind the goal, but alongside the main stand here, there's been a collapse there as well. Right beneath our television gantry. Chairman, having transferred one youngster who was caught up in that bit of trouble when the walls collapsed, delivering a couple of the unfortunates to the safer end of the field. So the crowd are off the pitch. It's going to be a drop ball on the centre line. We've had a delay of something like 5 to 6 minutes, and there's still a lot of work being done behind that John Jackson goal. But away we go again now. Here's Joe Mayo on the ball for Orient.
Well, we've got supporters coming onto this ground now, down in the left-hand corner. One would imagine they might well be Southampton supporters. This is not the first time we've seen supporters invading pitches this season when their team's been losing. But the stewards in those bibs have been quick to act. Mr. Bent will have to wait now. He's getting hold of the ball, he's watching the time. Of course, this has been the week when Leeds were banned from the from playing FA Cup matches at home for the next three seasons after just such a similar incident as this, when their supporters invaded the pitch when their team was losing. But the police now up on the terraces have managed to plug the hole over which the Southampton fans were pouring, and the stewards are containing this trouble. But they're still on the pitch, and there's no way the game can begin under these circumstances. Well, it looks as though good sense is beginning to prevail. The red and white scarves amongst those fans label them as Southampton supporters, but they are now beginning to realise that they are not going to be allowed to disrupt this match, and it will continue in just a few moments. Well, there will be an extra 2 or 3 minutes added for that interruption. Mr. Bent will need to make a note of that in his official report on the match. But happily, no great delay, and this match should now finish in the proper manner. Barry for Rovers, and a fine pass back. He's had a cool, experienced performance, this man Barry, today. Peter Aitken on the ball has been one of two fine Rovers fullbacks. Bobby Gould, number 9 there, has used all his cunning and experience to keep Rovers moving in the right direction. Young Pulis has worked hard and completely justified his selection in midfield today.